poor little pup is starting to get a little old. He's having some problems with his hip and with his eye. Poor guy's like 13 years old. And it's starting to be rough. You wanna hang out up here while Daddy mixes?
You go find a comfy spot to lay down.
Okay.
That looks like a good spot right there.
What's up everyone, Cole Caperin here. Thanks for stopping by for another video. I really appreciate it. Before we get into this one, don't forget to subscribe and hit the bell icon next to the subscribe tab. Give me a thumbs up, drop me a comment, let me know what you do to get ready for a mix. So I thought this would actually be kind of a fun one because there are absolutely some things that I do to get ready for mixing. So first thing in the morning, I wake up, I try to get a shower in before my daughter wakes up, and then I get her up, get her ready for daycare, and then I take her to daycare. Very next thing after that, coffee. I also take some supplements. I take a good multivitamin. And yes, all of this stuff plays into mixing. Then I come up in the studio and I flip everything on, and the entire time I'm trying to not be distracted. I'm trying to not play on my phone too much, not scroll on Facebook, not get wrapped up in political debates or arguments online. I don't look at the news. I try to really control my mental state going into a mix. And the other thing that I always do is, whether I'm mixing or mastering, it's always the very first thing that I do in the day. And so today I have a mix to do, and I also have a bunch of production work to do for an artist, but I'm absolutely gonna do the mix first because I have the freshest ears and I'm not fatigued. And it's a lot easier for me to play guitar tired than it is for me to mix tired. And so I'm very conscious of how I organize my day, so that way I'm in the best mental state and the freshest for the things that require the most intensity, the most focus. Did I mention coffee? Coffee. Okay, so the very next thing I do, and a lot of times I try to actually do this the night before, is clean. I actually clean my studio before I mix. There's something about the distraction of clutter, or the distraction, I mean, if you're at home in a home studio, the distraction of the dishes needing done can sometimes throw your mental state off. I want zero distractions. I want my brain to stop and think about zero other things. And so the first thing that I do, flip everything on, turn the AC down because it's 12 million degrees here in Nashville, and then I clean up. And at the very least, just clean up your actual work surface so that way you're not distracted. You're not looking at clutter while you're trying to be creative and while you're trying to mix. For me, that's a big deal, and I notice that I'm able to maintain focus for longer periods of time and more intent focus when I'm not looking at a cluttered desk. It kind of blows my mind how often I go into someone's studio, specifically home independent studios, not commercial studios, and there's just clutter everywhere. So much clutter. Guys, clean your shit up. Pick your studio up. On top of it being a healthier work environment, none of your clients want to see all your crap strewn all about the place. So clean up. All right, so the very next thing I do is pull up some references. Now, this is a very, very pop song that I'm working on today for an artist named Ty Black. And so we're going to pull up some, it's like Southern pop is what we're calling it. It's pop with a Southern country twist. So I'm gonna pull up some references. Unfortunately, I will just tell you guys the references because I can't actually put them on the video, otherwise the video will get yanked and demonetized. So that's no good. Okay, so the first reference is an artist by the name of Nico Moon. Good Time, I think, is the song. How much of this can I put on YouTube?
We just trying to catch it.
And then I'm going to calibrate my ears. I'm going to listen to this and a handful of other songs. I'm going to switch between the monitors, and this is just kind of getting my ears warmed up. And I'm just going to chill. I'm not analyzing it. I'm not like trying to pick the mix apart. I'm not trying to just hear how much 100 hertz the kick drum has. It's just a vibe thing. I'm just trying to chill out and acclimate and refamiliarize myself with the room and with the monitors. Yes, that might sound silly to some of you because I'm in here all day, every day, but it is a thing and it's what I do. I think Ed Sheeran will be next. Shape of You was like the biggest song of 2017, so that's a good reference. The lead vocal on Shape of You in the beginning actually doesn't sound that good. Sounds like it was recorded in a closet. interesting. Man, that is a testament to how much layered vocals, especially in pop music, are so important, because the lead vocal on itself doesn't really sound that good, but once they get all the layers in there, and the octaves, and the doubles, and the triples, the whole stack, it sounds pretty cool. You know, I think that's going to be a video. We're going to talk about how to layer pop vocals. You drop me a comment if you'd like to see how to layer pop vocals. Okay, so we've listened to a handful of songs, and I kind of got my ears warmed up. Unfortunately, I couldn't play any of it for you because YouTube. Sorry about that. So we're going to launch Pro Tools. And the first thing that I'm going to do is actually set the whole session up. Everything that I absolutely know for sure I'm going to do in the song, and I already have a good idea because I already know the song and have heard it. But I'm going to go ahead and set, I don't use any templates ever because I work on such a wide variety of music. And I always want the song to inform me on what the song needs. And I do or use the plugins or hardware. The decisions that I make, even the routing decisions, are based on what the song informs me that it needs. So on this particular song, I know exactly what I'm going to use on the mix bus. And so I, before even listening to the song, I won't make any adjustments, but I will go ahead and set the entire mix bus up. So on this particular song, the first thing I'm going to do is we're going to use a UAD Chandler curve bender. And I'm going to leave that completely flat, not adjusted. I don't know if you can see this. Can you see any of this? Let me turn this a little bit. I'm going to leave that completely flat, not adjusted, because I know I'm going to use that. And then I'm going to put a FabFilter Pro Q3 on there. And I am going to high pass this right about 25 hertz and switch this to natural phase. I'm going to go ahead and put my hardware on the mix bus, which is just a pair of Cappy Hyder preamps. The whole mix bus goes out through a pair of Cappy Hyder preamps, then into a Serpent SB4001 compressor, back into Pro Tools. Now, those are the things that I know for sure are going to be on my mix bus, so I'm going to go ahead and do that. And then after that, I know for sure that the vocal, the lead vocal, is going to go through my hardware. And so we are through my hardware vocal chain. And so we're going to go ahead and pull off a couple of these plugins and go ahead and patch in the hardware chain. Let's see, we're on 13. Now, one of the things that I do, you probably can't see this, but when I'm doing this, I'm leaving space before and after my plugin inserts. So I just put my hardware chain on the lead vocal, and there are four slots above it and five slots below it available. And I do this because I want the song to inform me. I know I'm going to use my hardware chain on this song, but I don't know what else I'm going to use. Am I going to put a de-esser before the hardware chain? Am I going to put another EQ before the hardware chain? Am I going to put a compressor after the chain? And so I leave room for myself to not have to undo any work or redo any work. Yes, I know some of you are thinking, well, just moving an insert slot is not that big of a deal. Efficiency, 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 efficiency. Everything that I do is in an effort to be fast and to react instantaneously on my intuition, on my gut for what the song needs. And every step, you know, moving an insert is not that big of a deal, but what if you had to move one insert on every single channel on an entire mix? Well, now that's a lot of time. And so on principle, I make as few moves as humanly possible throughout the mix. And this keeps my creativity alive. It keeps my workflow going, keeps my progress going, and it keeps me from, you know, hindering the inspiration, I guess. Something else I guess I should say, which happens at the end of the production, or if someone's sending me something to mix and I did not produce it myself, I produced this song myself, but if someone's sending me something to mix, the very first thing that I do is actually organize the session, lay out drums and bass and guitars and synthesizers and percussion, like lay it out exactly how I want. And I lay out every single song exactly the same way. Always starts with the kick drum and then works its way through the drums, regardless of whether it's electronic or acoustic. And if there's both, if there's electronic and acoustic, it's going to go all acoustic drums and then all electric drums. Then it's going to be whatever bass elements are in there, bass guitar, bass synthesizers, any sort of bass elements are going to be very next. After that, it's all the acoustic instruments, acoustic guitar. If I'm doing country, it's banjo and dobro, whatever acoustic instruments, acoustic stringed instruments, piano are next. Then after that, it's all the electronic instruments, synthesizers and you know, electric guitars and all that kind of stuff. And then after that, it's all the vocals. Lead vocals first, always the lead vocal first, then the doubles, triples, whatever stacks, whatever handoffs there are. Then after that, it's all the harmonies and background vocals and additional effects and stuff like that. And so every single song, regardless of the genre or the song itself, this is the layout and this is what I'm doing on every single song. And again, this is in an effort to make sure I make as few moves as possible and I'm as least held back by the technical as humanly possible. Yeah, we were falling in love. So because I know there's going to be plenty of comments about this, the difference in volume that you're actually hearing on those two examples is, believe it or not, the difference in RMS level between my rough with no processing whatsoever, those are just raw tracks, and the mix with everything that is on a mix. Now, I've talked about this in other videos on how to get loud masters, and part of the reason is because the mixes are so loud, and it is a product of how I actually mix. I actually just posted this on my Insta story the other day. If you don't follow me on Instagram, hit me up on Instagram, because I'm posting stuff like this a lot. I was working on a mix, and the mix ended up at minus 6.6 LUFS, and that's with no limiting whatsoever. And so if you mix in the appropriate way, your masters can end up being really, really loud. And I've been trying to figure out how to actually convey this in a video, but it's really difficult. So believe it or not, that's actually the mix. So I really hope this helped you figure out a better way to approach your mixes, and I hope that you get better mixes if you employ some of these things that I do before every single mix. Don't forget to subscribe and give me a thumbs up on this one and hit the bell icon next to the subscribe tab. It really helps me out a lot. It helps the channel out a lot, and comments help out a lot as well. The more you guys interact, the more traction the video gets, which means the more videos I can justify making. So thank you guys so much for watching and subscribing, and I'll see you in the next one. Yeah, we were falling in love without no